Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents On Operations, Operational Art and Military Disciplines by B.A. Friedman. Narrated by Derek Dysart. Preface. This book, like my previous book, is Clausewitzian. By that, I mean that it falls within a framework of what war, warfare, strategy, and tactics are as a phenomenon as described by Karl von Clausewitz, 1780-1831. Olivia Gerard, rhyming with Alfred North Whitehead, has said that all strategic theory is a series of footnotes to Clausewitz. I would instead say that all good strategic theory is a series of footnotes to Clausewitz. Good footnotes to Clausewitz is all I hope these books to be. If you are looking for something non-Clausewitzian, this is not it. There are certainly publications that can provide that, but I do not recommend any of them. This volume would still be a formless jumble of notes were it not for my wife, Ashton, whose comment triggered the chapter that really ties the whole book together. During one conversation, Colonel Doug King, U.S. Marine Corps, retired, said one sentence that clarified all my thinking about the command and control chapter. Control is what the staff does. I have a lot to thank Doug King for, but this is the one most relevant for this book. Captain Wayne Hughes, U.S. Navy, retired, greatly influenced my previous book, On Tactics, A Theory of Victory in Battle, 2017. And generously shared his experience and knowledge with me as I worked through the manuscript for that volume. He was also instrumental in its acceptance for publication. In December 2019, he passed away. His influence will live on in the naval and strategic theory communities, and I remain grateful for his guidance. Fair winds and following seas. Conversations with colleagues have sharpened the ideas contained herein on a number of occasions, especially those with Lieutenant Colonel Gregory Wardman, U.S. Marine Corps retired, and Captain Olivia Gerard, U.S. Marine Corps. Olivia especially helped me think through the campaign taxonomy, while Greg considerably shaped my thoughts on the information discipline. I owe them both a debt of gratitude. David Allman pointed me in the direction of motivator hygiene theory, which strengthened the chapter on administration. There are two weaknesses in this book, I believe. One is an unfortunate focus on so-called Western history and thought. This is a function both of the paucity of sources readily available to an independent writer such as myself, and the fact that the operational level of war is a fundamentally Western concept. So, while the operational art of the People's Liberation Army, or PLA, of modern China is an interesting subject, its discussion is excluded from the following chapters. Briefly, however, current PLA thought has what might be described as four levels: military thought, Junxi Xixian; military strategy, Zan Lue; campaigns, Zan Yi; and tactics, Zan Shu. Nonetheless, these concepts do not exactly map to Western conceptions of the operational level or operational art, which is the focus of this book. Western writers sometimes conflate campaigns, joint warfare, and the operational level when describing PLA ideas, but this is a misunderstanding of U.S. doctrine and an assumption about Chinese thought. For example, the Western operational level of war is sometimes depicted as the ways part of an ends, ways, means formulation of strategy. But the ways of this construct is more similar to the Chinese idea of strategic mean, Zan Lue Shudang, than to the operational level. Works in English that connect Western, especially American, doctrinal concepts with PLA doctrinal concepts as direct equivalents should be viewed with extreme skepticism. The Chinese do not have a military doctrine as it is understood in Western militaries, but rather a unique style of military regulation that precludes easy comparison. Those interested in the PLA especially should see M. Taylor Fravel, Active Defense, Chinese Military Strategy Since 1949, published in 2019. The other weakness herein is an excessive focus on land warfare. This is a function entirely of my own shortcomings and background when it comes to aviation and naval operations. I have made an attempt to include more on those subjects than I did in my previous book, but the attention is still far less than they deserve. This book, like the last, is not a work of history, but one of theory. It uses history extensively for evidence and explanation to support the theory, but is not intended to be a work of history. It therefore relies mostly on secondary sources. Primary sources in the form of doctrinal manuals and, in one case, a discussion between myself and an author of doctrinal manuals were used. But secondary sources necessarily underpin the development of the theory itself. If there is any one takeaway from this book and on tactics, it's that there is no one route to victory in war. There are too many factors that come into play, and theory is at its best when it helps one think about those factors without trying to prescribe solutions. Where I prescribe solutions, they address organizational issues. Hopefully, that is what this book is, a tool for greater clarity. I hesitate to say that I am following in Clausewitz's footsteps, except in one respect, that he railed against the purveyors of shallow prescriptions, salesmen promising success if only the proper rules and guides are followed. There are no new rules of war, just as there were no old ones. There are no guarantees and no certainties. There are definitely no simple answers. Anyone saying otherwise is selling snake oil. Unfortunately, there is far too much of that in the defense world today, growing and accumulating on the U.S. military especially, like plague. Some of it comes from academia, some of it from the political punditry rackets on the right and left. Some of it, like the operational level of war, grows from misunderstandings within the U.S. military itself. But all war is subject to probabilities, so there is no way to know whether or not my attack on this particular misunderstanding will be as successful as Clausewitz's was. The only way to know is to launch it. Introduction. A revolution is an idea that has found its bayonets. Napoleon Bonaparte. Regarding the general staff system that first sprang up in Prussia and then spread throughout Europe and the world, Sir Michael Howard writes, "This general staff was perhaps the great military innovation of the 19th century." On Operations argues that Howard was correct and that general staffs were developed to cope with the expanding complexity and scale of modern warfare since the Napoleonic Wars, 1803 to 1815. At the same time, another coping mechanism was the invention of the operational level of war, a concept that is, this book argues, problematic at best and ruinous at worst. In contrast, operational art, a sister concept, is useful as a descriptor of what military staffs do to support and sustain tactics in the pursuit of strategy. The operational art performed by staffs is best described in theory as a set of disciplines, commonly known as warfighting functions. The military success usually attributed, wrongly, to the discovery of an operational level of war should instead be credited to the rise of general staffs. This adoption of the operational level by Western militaries especially has amputated tactics from strategy, with tragic effect, and blinded those militaries from effectively instituting military staffs. My previous book, On Tactics, focused on the commanders of military units who are responsible for employing force against an opposing military force. Commanders are, necessarily, tacticians. On Operations focuses on staff officers who support those commanders by performing the functions of operational art. While tactical acumen is certainly desirable and useful to any staff officer, these people do not perform tactics. This also applies to major subordinate commands of a unit, whose own staffs perform operational art at their level. The operational level of war. Although the invention of the operational level of war is usually credited to the Red Army of the Soviet Union, this is a myth. The Soviets began using the term operations and operational art to refer to the increasing complexity of planning military operations, and perhaps also as a way of discussing strategy without the risk of voicing ideas contrary to those of founder Vladimir Lenin, who fancied himself a strategist. Lenin's view of strategy was permeated with politics. In a speech in 1917, he claimed, "It seems to me that the most important thing that is usually overlooked in the question of the war is the question of the class character of the war. What caused that war? What classes are waging it? And what historical and historico-economic conditions gave rise to it?" He went on to quote Clausewitz, of whom he was a devotee, but twists the meaning of the Clausewitzian view of war as a political contest to one of class struggle. "War is a continuation of policy by other means. All wars are inseparable from the political systems that engender them. The policy which a given state, a given class within that state, pursued for a long time before the war is inevitably continued by that same class during the war, the form of action alone being changed." Strategy was spoken for in the Soviet system. Joseph Stalin assumed the mantle of master strategist from Lenin, and operational art became the safe space in which Soviet officers could discuss their trade. Sometime thereafter, when these ideas and terms spread to other military forces, the concept morphed into the idea of an operational level. Be that as it may, warfare was indeed becoming more complex as a result of the Industrial Revolution, and the idea of an operational level of war was a possible way to cope with that expanding intricacy. While warfare has always been complex, after the Industrial Revolution, the sustainable size of armies increased, as did their rates of fire, effective range, and movement. The complexity of weapon systems increased, causing a concomitant expansion of all manner of sustainment, spare parts, fuel, oil, and the level of training and expertise required by service members. The Russian army was directly presented with this complexity, not just due to the fact that they were defeated by Germany in World War I, 1914 through 1918, and then immediately fought a civil war, but also during the latter they had to build a new military from scratch, and along Marxist-Leninist ideological lines as well. These two aspects of the concept, that it was a response to Marxist-Leninist requirements and the complexity of industrial warfare, remain its most solid distinguishing characteristics even today. Proponents of the operational level of war view it as a politics-free zone where commanders could demonstrate their mastery of managing large forces over wide areas in a series of complex engagements. Its relationship to strategy and tactics is hierarchical. Strategy passes down objectives or goals to the operational level, which further passes them down to the tactical level. At times, it has been viewed as grand tactics, at other times as closer to strategy. Its apolitical and complex nature, however, has remained constant, even though the concept quickly devolved into competing sets of definitions. Some have defined it as a level of command, such as the core levels and above. Others have simply used scale, as in the numbers of men and amount of material involved, as well as the distance over which military forces could travel. Still others have focused on its function. For example, Jim Storr has described it thus: "Operational art is the link. It concerns the planning, sequencing, resourcing, and conducting a series of battles or tactics within a theater in order to achieve the strategic objectives of the campaign." Yet he also refers to it as a level of command above the division. Still elsewhere in the same book, the operational level is defined by large units and very large distances. Almost all proponents peg the emergence of the operational level to changes in warfare sometime during the decades between the Napoleonic Wars and World War II, 1939 to 1945. There were indeed many changes during this period, and Chapter 2 argues that modern war began with the Napoleonic Wars. But the idea of an operational level poorly captures the changes and dynamics that led modernity. Robert M. Epstein, professor at the U.S. Army School of Military Studies, and one of the originators of the concept, sees the emergence of an operational level during the Napoleonic Wars. He describes operational campaigns as characterized by symmetrical conscript armies organized into corps, maneuvered in a distributed fashion so that tactical engagements are sequenced and often simultaneous. Command is decentralized, yet the commanders have a common understanding of operations methods. Victory is achieved by the cumulative effects of tactical engagements and operational campaigns. This is as solid a description of the operational level as can be found, since it accounts for all the aspects generally attributed to the concept: scale, maneuvered in a distributed fashion; command level, the use of corps and decentralized command; doctrine, common operational methods; and the linking of tactics across time, sequenced into cumulative effects. The problem is that none of the aspects in this description was new to the Napoleonic Wars. Every one of them occurred well before, sometimes centuries before the time when Epstein claims they emerged, and were not even new in European history. The identified attributes are also aspects of, to highlight only major conflicts in Europe, the Peloponnesian Wars, 431 to 405 BC, the Second Punic War, 218 to 202 BC, the Gallic Wars, 58 to 50 BC, the Roman Civil War, 49 to 45 BC, the Arab Conquests, AD 622 to 750, the Mongol Conquest, AD 1237 to 1291, the Seven Years' War, French and Indian War, AD 1756 to 1763, and the American War for Independence, AD 1775 to 1783. The only exception is the use of the word corps to describe units of that size. But corps-sized organizations were certainly used prior to that point, as was the articulation inherent in the corps system. The emergence of a new level based on the presence of ancient characteristics is patently absurd. As we shall see, this conceptual inconsistency is common across the literature on the operational level of war, even among its supposed inventors, the Red Army. This is not solely a problem of definition, it is a problem with the concept itself. The operational level of war cannot find solid purchase as an idea because there is simply no logical space for it. The parameters described before are frequently cited interchangeably, but never is the logic of the operational level of war addressed. The classic definitions of tactics and strategy, those descended from Clausewitz's On War, focus on their logic. What distinguishes them is not level of command, scale, size, or even complexity. Rather, it is their logic that made the difference for Clausewitz. The logic of tactics is to gain battlefield victory. The logic of strategy is to use those victories for the purpose of the war. The first is linear. The second is nonlinear. These definitions leave no logical space for an operational level of war, no matter how big the operation. They have linear logic, defeat the opponent, and therefore have the same logic as tactics. As soon as the operational level moves closer to strategy, politics and strategic effect become involved, and the nonlinear logic of strategy takes over. Nor are strategy and tactics strictly hierarchical, as proponents of the operational level of war claim. Rather, they exist in a dialectic relationship, a relationship broken by the insertion of the operational level of war. The result is an orphan concept shoehorned into a theory of war that neither requires it nor has room for it. Harold R. Winton, a professor at the U.S. Air Force School of Advanced Air and Space Studies, has written that military theory's first task is to define the field of study, and its second task is to categorize. The conflicting, confusing, and capricious concepts of an operational level of war failed this test, neither producing a solid definition of the field of study nor assisting in the categorization within that larger field. Indeed, they simply complicate categorization already accomplished. The operational art of war. A related but distinct concept to the operational level of war is operational art, which Soviet military thinkers did pioneer. Despite their distinction, the terms are frequently used interchangeably. Milan Vigo describes operational art as a component of military art concerned with the theory and practice of planning, preparing, conducting, and sustaining campaigns and major operations aimed at accomplishing strategic or operational objectives in a given theater. This is a bit of a circular definition, and Vigo also uses operational art as synonymous with the operational level of war. Yet, the focus on planning, preparation, conducting, and sustaining military actions is compelling, and these activities are distinct from both tactics and strategy. Vigo is not alone in this view. Shimon Neve, an influential proponent of the operational level of war, has written, "The essence of this level is the preparation, planning, and conduct of military operations." Operational art has more in common with what Clausewitz referred to as preparations for war, which is distinct from the conduct thereof, which is the realm of tactics and strategy. We can better ascertain the place of operational art if it is disconnected with the operational level. Removing operational art from the requirements of its own level, which would require their own logic, allows us to ground it in something besides the vague linking of tactics and strategy and retain it as a descriptor of planning, preparing, conducting, and sustaining military operations. It still requires a foundation in tactics and still requires a connection to strategy, but it no longer encroaches on or interposes itself between them. Operational art, then, is the planning, preparation, synchronization, and sustainment of tactics over a sustained period of time, a large geographic expanse, or both. The linear logic of tactics remains the same, victory in combat, as does the non-linear logic of strategy, using combat results to secure an advantageous peace. Operational art comprises the disciplines required to place military forces in an advantageous position to employ tactics to achieve strategic effect. Because it remains tied by tactical tenets to achieve that advantage, yet beholden to strategy to give it direction, it exhibits no logic of its own. Operational art is a supporting effort to both. Pushback against the operational level. Of course, the widespread acceptance of the operational level of war is not total. The concept and its proponents have their opponents. In 2009, Justin Kelly and Mike Brennan wrote a report for the U.S. Army Strategic Studies Institute titled "Alien: How Operational Art Devoured Strategy." It was an inauspicious time for American strategy. The previous presidential administration had mired the country in two strategically aimless quagmires. A new administration would involve it in yet more of the same. The operational level of war as a doctrinal concept was in constant practice, and it was uniformly failing. The U.S. military, far from exhibiting the mastery of a link between tactics and strategy, was instead clearly and painfully adrift. Kelly and Brennan conclude that when the Soviet concept of an operational level of war was copied into U.S. Army doctrine without the historical or doctrinal context, it severed campaign planning from the concept of strategy. This produced an American conception of war that magnified the importance of campaigns and tactics while minimizing the importance of strategy. Decades of intellectual effort to ascertain the connection between tactics and strategy, from Clausewitz on, were simply jettisoned. Another commentator, William F. Owen, also strongly disagrees with the concept of the operational level of war. He makes a similar argument, agreeing that the operational level not only undermines strategy, but also, in so doing, marginalizes tactics. The idea of the operational level as a link between the two also falls flat. Tactics and strategy are inextricably linked already, having been understood as such for centuries. Owen goes on to argue, convincingly, that the adoption of the operational level of war has led to a poor understanding of tactics in Western militaries, reflected in turn in the practice of bad tactics on the battlefield. Still, another critique is the inconsistent definition of the operational level of war. This is found in U.S. Army doctrine itself, as will be seen. Sir Hugh Strachan, a British military historian, has also found this problematic, describing how the operational level has described strategy at some times and tactics at others, never finding its own purchase. He writes, "Operational art has been stretched hither and yon because it is not contained by a sure grasp of the relationship between war and policy, and by proper structures to debate and guide strategy." To be fair, he goes on to write that, once they exist, operational art and the operational level of war will rediscover both their true purpose and their proper place. An equally likely outcome, however, is that the operational level of war will discover that it has no place. A sure grasp of war and policy, and the tactics that underpin them, has no need for it. Nor is this limited to American doctrine. Major Will Vigors of the Australian Defense Force has also written about how his country's doctrine struggles to explain coherently the rationale for these levels, as their conceptions are confused and blurred. This confusion is worldwide. Strategic theorist Colin S. Gray has also written about the operational level. He defines operations as combinations of purposefully linked military engagements, generally though not necessarily on a large scale. Operations are strategy as action. Gray also warns that the interpolation of an operational level of war between strategy and tactics, far from being a link, may more often than not be a barrier between the two, or worse, an excuse to ignore one or the other. For him, operations are about the orchestration of military action, or tactics. Orchestration is less of a level than an independent act of arranging. A symphony also requires orchestration of various groups of instruments, but the principles of musical theory, rhythm, melody, chords, and harmony, among others, do not change in the act. Gray's vision of operations, then, is closer to operational art than to the operational level. The concept of an operational level of war is failing also in practice, not just in theory. Jonathan Schroden has written about how U.S. policymakers are increasingly turning to special operations forces to bypass the operational level of war and connect tactical actions by small groups of military individuals direct to strategic aims. This is a recognition by national leadership that tactical action and strategic effects must be linked and that conventional forces have lost the know-how required for this. Both the concept of an operational level and the bureaucracy that has accreted around it have disabled American strategy to the point where a large portion of the U.S. military forces, those that are thought to work on the operational level, are viewed as ineffective, placing more and more of a burden on a small number of special operators. These critics, theorists, analysts, and others have warned about the deleterious effects of the concept of the operational level of war. This is not, however, just an exercise in academic debate. War is a human phenomenon, executed by real people. Conducting it on the basis of erroneous assumptions and concept is just as much a threat to their lives as the actions of the enemy force they encounter. Understanding the operational level of war and operational art, therefore, is not pure pedantry and sophistry. It has real implications in real-world engagements, both for policymakers and for military personnel. Conclusion. The conventional wisdom regarding the operational level of war is that it was created either by the Germans or the Soviets in response to the increasing complexity, scope, and scale of war during and after the Industrial Revolution, with the United States and others adopting it in response. As we shall see, this has never been true, no matter how many times it has been or will be asserted. Nor is the creation of operational or theater commands equivalent to an operational level of war. We will see many different ideas on which command level is operational and which are not, but the sources examined will indicate such chaotic confusion about this concept that it ultimately has no purchase. Tactics and strategy were not and are not conceived as a command level. Attempts to do so for the operational level of war have only failed. Clausewitz has a test for theory. The first business of every theory is to clear up conceptions and ideas which have been jumbled together, and, we may say, entangled and confused. The operational level of war fails this test. It has introduced confusion and misconceptions to both tactical theory and strategic theory, entangling and confusing them. Operational art, however, rightly understood, passes Clausewitz's test by clarifying the role of staffs, the military disciplines they bring to war and warfare, and how they contribute to tactics and strategy. These two concepts must be disentangled, and the latter cut away from the whole. The operational level of war is intimately connected with World War I. It was military organizations, especially the Red Army, trying to look for an answer to the problems of industrial war that defined the concept that eventually became the operational level. Since then, however, its nebulous nature has made it flexible enough to be anything to anyone, doing little but introducing confusion as to the nature of war and strategy, amputating strategy from tactics and undermining the efficacy of both. Nor was World War I examined holistically. The Soviets especially focused on conditions in Europe during that war and the Russian Civil War, 1918 to 1921, which closely followed it. Ignored were other theaters of the Great War, such as the Middle East and Africa. There, military operations did not resemble whatsoever the stasis that pertained on the Western Front in Europe. Naval operations were also disregarded. Other military conflicts throughout South America and in North America were similarly dismissed. A concept claiming to apply to all warfare was predicated solely on a very restrictive and unique data set. Of course, this was not clear to the Soviets at the time. From the perspective of the 1920s and 1930s, the European Western Front certainly seemed to be typical. We know now that it was not. Clausewitz's definition of strategy and tactics based on the logic of each is sound. Not only has it pertained since his time, but no proponent of the operational level of war, nor any institutional doctrine seriously disagrees that the two should be characterized by their function. Certainly, there are definitional differences. Disagreements about where one ends and the other begins, and even disputes about what the functions of each are. But there is wide agreement that their logic is determinant. Such agreement breaks down, however, upon considering the operational level. Some define it as scale, some define it as level of command, while others define it as practice. Some do not bother to define it at all, and others use multiple conflicting definitions with abandon. Aspects of operational art and the Soviet system, not to mention its origins in Marxist orthodoxy, were stitched together to fit neatly in between pre-existing conceptions of tactics and strategy in the West. The resultant Frankenstein's monster has proven remarkably difficult to kill. Yet, even if its origin was sound, based on a thorough understanding of Soviet doctrine, and transferred faithfully and accurately to American strategic thought, the operational level would still be problematic, It has destroyed the understanding of the relationship between strategy and tactics and damaged the effectiveness of the U.S. military in real and practical ways. Its confused and shallow origins only lend weight to the necessity of striking it from strategic theory. The concept of the operational level of war remains unconvincing and, to echo Colin Gray and others, dangerous. But the debate has raged for so long and at such an intensity because the idea of operational art is convincing. Vigo's view of operational art as support to campaigns, which are composed of tactics and guided by strategy, makes sense. Ascribing a supporting role to operational art, however, does not require the operational level of war, and we should be wary not to throw the operational art baby out with the operational level bathwater. What is left is a view of operational art as a parallel discipline that performs its supporting but not unimportant role, planning, preparing, conducting, and sustaining, for tacticians and strategists without the erroneous interpolation of a new and specious level of war. Clausewitz refers to these activities as those required for the maintenance of the military force and preparations for fighting, differentiating them from combat itself, and therefore tactics. This bears out most conspicuously in campaigns. Although the operational level of war is sometimes also referred to as a campaign level, a campaign is just a grouping of connected tactical actions. The principles of tactics do not change in the grouping. While operational art is defined by its role and not as a level, it can be tied to physical forces. Not to corps, front, army, or division level, for such units are tactical and employ tactics, albeit at larger scale than smaller units. Not to the nexus of political and military objectives, for this remains the province of strategy. Rather, operational art is the realm of the staff, the organizations that act to support and arrange tactics to achieve strategic effect. Operational art is what military staffs do to manage the complexity of modern warfare as a parallel supporting function to strategy and tactics, without there being an interposing operational level of war. The following study seeks to make an admittedly small contribution to rescuing both strategy and tactics from the problems identified by Kelly, Brennan, and Owen. 1. Operations and the Napoleonic Revolution. In historic events, the so-called great men are labels giving names to events, and like labels, they have but the smallest connection with the event itself. Leo Tolstoy. The Napoleonic Revolution occurred when a number of developments, military and non-military, all made progress and matured simultaneously, drastically changing the character of warfare. Napoleon Bonaparte, 1769 to 1821, himself was responsible for almost none of these developments. Yet they did coincide with his career, and he first understood their import. Despite the fact that he was a user rather than an originator of many of these developments, Napoleon was probably, and definitely mathematically, the best general of all time. He was lucky enough to be born so as to enter the French military at the tail end of what Professor Christy Piccicaro has identified as the Military Enlightenment. A component of the wider intellectual movement known as the Enlightenment, it was a period of increased rationality and scientific examination of military events and organizations. This was the beginning of modern war. Chris Habels Gray attributes the development of modern war to three trends that began during the 16th century: a growing preference for rationality over tradition, the creation of military administration, and the application of science and technology. Napoleon's brilliance was his ability to combine the disparate military advancements of his age on the battlefield itself. These trends were tinder, and the French Revolutionary armies, with Napoleon at their head, were the spark. Still, the idea of military revolution is a tricky subject. Historians and theorists usually pinpoint the introduction of new technologies as revolutionary, but this rarely, if ever, displaces everything else already there. The introduction of gunpowder cannon displaced the catapult and trebuchet, for example, but not infantry or cavalry. Additionally, artillery assumed the same role as earlier siege weapons, at least initially. Nor did the introduction of personal firearms among the infantry and cavalry immediately invalidate earlier weapons. Even today, infantry still carry bayonets. Across history, technological progress breeds evolutionary, not revolutionary, changes in warfare. The Napoleonic Revolution, however, was not strictly about technology. Rather, it was about the rational integration of technology with systemic planning and professionalized armies. These were political changes in the makeup of European states that subsequently enabled changes in warfare. Larger armies, better trained and supplied, operating farther from their own territory. This did not produce a change in war itself. War was and is a complex sociological phenomenon produced by the dynamic interaction of rational, irrational, and non-rational forces in and between populations. It did, however, make warfare more complex. No longer could armies consist of hastily assembled and trained groups of illiterate peasants without the wherewithal to avoid the press gang or even hired mercenaries. Weapons became weapon systems manned by crews of technicians. Armies became bureaucracies and begat ministries to administer and support them. The miles that military units could travel multiplied as fast as the number of mouths it was necessary to feed and the feet it was necessary to keep in shoes. The complexity of warfare outpaced the intellect of conscripts, mercenaries, and the pampered nobility. Only the career professional could gain the expertise necessary to manage the application of organized violence. Western military officers and politicians did not miss these changes, but Napoleon was the first to unite them all in practice. This combination ushered in modern warfare and, with it, operational art as the domain of the staff officer. The Enlightenment. Philosophers thought about everything, war included. Both philosophers like Jean-Jacques Rousseau and Immanuel Kant and military thinkers rejected the idea of war as a normal, even noble, outlet for the aristocracy and monarchs to achieve glory. War came to be viewed as a necessary evil, a critical component in its professionalization. Prior to the Enlightenment, military officers were seen as noble and professional, while enlisted soldiers and sailors were treated with contempt and as servants by their own officers, as well as society. After the reign of Louis XIV, this began to change, with reformers decrying the poor effect on morale and the consequent poor performance of soldiers, and proposing instead a military society that included all those who served in uniform as brothers in arms. The non-military aspects of Enlightenment thought are beyond the scope of this work, but those ideas still affected the military environment at the turn of the 19th century. After the French Revolution, the Girondins, upon seizing power, launched no less than a war of worldwide liberation. It was not just this bellicosity that changed warfare, however. Rationality led to more effective institutions and, thus, better exploitation of a country's potential. Michael Howard states, "The growing capacity of European governments to control or at least to tap the wealth of the community and from it to create mechanisms, bureaucracies, fiscal systems, armed forces, which enable them yet further to extend their control over the community is one of the central developments in the historical era which, opening in the latter part of the 17th century, has continued to our own time." In economic terms, a global economy began to emerge as travel and international communication became more reliable. This led many thinkers to believe that war would become extinct since it would disrupt commerce and trade. Instead, economic policies quickly became a servant of war, most notably for Napoleon himself, whose continental system was an attempt to weaken and thus defeat Great Britain through the imposition of a continent-wide economic blockade. The scientific revolution also affected warfare. Improvements in agriculture meant that more food could be produced for armies, while improvements in storage meant that food could be transported to wherever those armies might be. Improved road surfaces throughout Europe, following the scientific examination of road construction by French engineer Pierre Tressoguet, meant that not only could armies move faster, but so too could the food and supplies necessary to sustain them. It was also during this period that detailed and, comparatively, accurate maps became increasingly available. A rational and scientific approach to medicine also found use in the military sphere. French military doctors sent reports on experiments and observations back to the War Ministry from various posts throughout the colonies. These were collected into a journal, printed, and distributed to medical professionals by the army free of charge. Enlightenment militaries. The most important effect of the Enlightenment for the armed forces, however, was how it changed militaries themselves. Again, Michael Howard comments on the change in military affairs. By the 18th century, European wars were being conducted by professional armed forces of a kind with which we would be familiar today. Their officers were not primarily members of a warrior caste fighting from a concept of honor or of feudal obligation, nor were they contractors doing a job for anyone who would pay them. They were servants of the state who were guaranteed regular employment, regular wages, and career prospects, and who dedicated themselves to the service of the state, or rather of their country, come peace, come war. Even prior to the French Revolution, the military enlightenment caused drastic changes. Frederick the Great invented the division, which was adopted by France in 1759. Corps, brigades, and battalions were standardized. Other reforms in the French Royal Army included better soldier pay and barracks, the establishment of military schools, and equipment modernization. Larger armies were now also possible. This, combined with the expulsion of officers who had gained ranks solely on the basis of their family lineage and wealth, allowed young, talented officers to rise very quickly. Napoleon, for example, was made a general at 24. These modernized forces began to fight more for their nation than for a paycheck, although group solidarity was another strong motivation, especially among veteran troops. On the battlefield, light infantry performing screening and skirmishing functions was another innovation, enabled by rifled weapons that allowed these troops to disrupt opposing formations prior to the charge of heavy infantry or cavalry. Around 1808, the distinction between light and heavy infantry disappeared. Artillery also matured, organized into siege artillery, field artillery to support infantry, and horse artillery to support cavalry. Cannons were sometimes centralized into a reserve and held to fire at a decisive point or dispersed and used in direct support of individual infantry units. By necessity, artillery officers attained a higher level of professionalization than other arms, leading Frederick the Great to criticize their jargon and pretensions. Even before Napoleon, the French army was at the cutting edge of military innovation, although few improvements were not yet fully institutionalized. The use of divisions was proposed by Pierre-Joseph Borsay, a French officer, in 1775. Most infantry forces attacked in a column formation instead of the line of battle, emphasizing shock action. The line formation was sometimes used for offense, but more often for defense to maximize firepower. A British innovation, the two-rank line, was brutally effective and one of the few new methods tried but not adopted by Napoleon. This formation depended on expertise in marksmanship, a British specialty. French troops, whose leaders preferred massed firepower and shock, could not match them. Howard has also pointed to the importance of civil bureaucracies in manning, training, and equipping national armies. The increasing size and complexity of military organizations necessitated the curation of bureaucracies to create and administer military policy, and they began rationalizing and systematizing military affairs. The civil bureaucracy under Lazare Carnot steered the French army through the years of the Revolution, modernizing much of it even before Napoleon's time. The Napoleonic Revolution. Napoleon Bonaparte was perhaps the first to see the practical potential of the military enlightenment and the scientific revolution for warfare. Here, the word revolution is used as Albert Camus defined it. Revolution is the injection of ideas into historical experience. A revolution is an attempt to shape actions to ends, to fit the world into a theoretic frame. Napoleon literally did this, executing the theoretical ideas of French Enlightenment military sophists such as the Comte de Gilbert, Borsay, and Maurice, Comte de Saxe. In the words of historian Robert S. Quimby, Napoleon alone clearly took advantage of all that was thus made available. Drawing from these varied sources, he welded them into a consistent practice far superior to any previously employed. Of course, revolution is a bit of a rhetorical flourish. Historian Clifford J. Rogers has described how warfare evolves as akin to the biological evolution in a process of punctuated equilibrium. In a punctuated equilibrium, there are periods of slow, nearly static changes, punctuated by periods of rapid change, usually in response to the previous period of rapid change. This process certainly occurred over centuries in Europe before Napoleon. What was different about the Napoleonic punctuation is that it was revolutionary in the sense of Camus. Napoleon unlocked the potential of that long process of punctuated equilibrium in both military and political senses. Warfare's long evolution and the Enlightenment seeded the wind, but it was Napoleon's mastery of every aspect of these changes that led to the whirlwind. That revolution was expressed in the next few decades of war. Revolutionary France aimed not at occupying foreign territory in order to extract concessions from established government, but rather to uproot those governments entirely and replace them with one similar to its own. Napoleon would do the same, redrawing the map of Europe, creating and destroying nations and imposing the Civil Code of France or the Napoleonic Code. There was a clear inflection point in warfare centered on Napoleon's career and specifically around the year 1800. Historian Anders Engberg Petersen calls this point an epistemological revolution, in which warfare became a problem of knowledge. The Enlightenment and other intellectual movements, like Romanticism, re-examined military affairs. The knowledge necessary to understand warfare and employ military forces in combat became far too expansive for one human brain to comprehend, heralding the end of singular generalship. One eventual response, as we shall see, was the extension of the human brain by forming a collective of brains, a staff, with each brain responsible for a certain discipline. From a young age, Napoleon was enamored with military subjects, although he read many subjects and even tried his hand as a novelist. He first gained fame when he took over command of French forces at the Siege of Toulon, 1793, where he personally led troops to seize enemy redoubts and then operated cannon after crewmen were killed to deal Britain's Royal Navy a rare defeat, being wounded himself in the process. He was beyond comparison as a tactical commander, but his greatest strength was perhaps his Enlightenment-inspired egalitarian leadership. In an age when most European generals viewed their soldiers as little more than beasts of burden, Napoleon fawned on his enlisted troops, remembered their names, and was genuinely concerned for their well-being and equipment. The soldiers returned his attention in kind, fighting and drilling at a higher level than their opponents. The Grande Armée was the most direct reflection of Napoleon's vision. initially formed in 1803 as the Army of England for a cross-channel invasion, it was wholly designed by Napoleon, down to individual weapons and uniforms. When he abandoned plans to invade Britain, Napoleon instead turned this force eastward and rechristened it the Grande Armée. For almost 2 years previously, these troops were incessantly trained and drilled to ready them for the invasion. By the time the army was put to use elsewhere, it consisted of about 350,000 of the best trained and best organized professional troops on the planet. The key innovation of the Grande Armée, however, was the corps system. Napoleon's corps, self-contained combined arms units with infantry, artillery, and cavalry under a single commander, were unique at this time. They could combine to fight together as a single army or maneuver and fight independently. That flexibility enabled better and more responsive tactical dispositions, such as the manoeuvre de derrière and fighting from a central position. At times, Napoleon would place his army between two enemy armies, risking a two-front fight, but depending on the speed and responsiveness of his corps to first attack and defeat one, then the other. Napoleon attempted to reform the entirety of the three combat arms, infantry, artillery, and cavalry, and institutionalized the use of a tactical reserve. Not all of his reforms took root, but the major change was the ability to use them together. Artillery would blast away at a chosen point on the enemy line. Infantry or heavy cavalry would then attack that point, and light cavalry stood by to exploit any breach, running down fleeing soldiers or outflanking other units. He was the first modern combined arms commander. The French army's logistics system was another of Napoleon's reforms. Supplies were traditionally gathered and carried by extremely corrupt civilian contractors until Napoleon militarized the process by forming transport battalions and a network of depots. Despite his efforts, a logistics system dependent on horsepower could never supply his massive army sufficiently, and they continued to subsist through looting and pillage. Napoleon has also been called the world's first media general. The use of the Chap telegraph system was significantly accelerated by Napoleon, who adopted it to campaign in Italy and Germany. His command of what today is referred to as information warfare extended across the whole of Europe, enabling him to confound and deceive opponents, as discussed in later chapters. Most important, Napoleon was the first to use a modern military staff system that is still in use today. As a young general, before his rise to power, he was posted to the French Historical and Topographical Bureau, which then planned military operations. It was there that he learned the importance of staff work, especially cartography and intelligence. This permanent staff was itself a new system. Prior to the Seven Years' War, what aides there were disbanded after hostilities. France was the first to set up a permanent staff, but adjutant generals were only assigned at the field army level in 1792. The invention of permanent staffs with professional officers is usually attributed to Borsay, who, because he was a low-ranking noble and thus could not command, became a key advisor in many wars prior to the French Revolution. In command, however, Napoleon would develop his own system. Prior to the advent of military staffs, armies and navies made military decisions via councils of war, in which the commander would assemble his major subordinates, solicit and pitch courses of action, and seek a consensus on which one to pursue. Napoleon eschewed such meetings once he had enough rank to forego them, calling them a cowardly proceeding, intended more to shift blame than to determine an effective plan. Instead, he built a staff that included members who were not military per se, but rather from the civilian government, such as the Secretariat, the Statistics Bureau, and the Topographical Bureau. Napoleon was the first military commander to employ a chief of staff in the modern sense, but the practice was not immediately institutionalized. He only ever had one chief of staff all the way to 1814, Alexandre Berthier. The chief of staff and his subordinates generally worked out the details of operational plans provided by Napoleon himself and handled written communications between the commander and his units. They also engaged in inter-unit communication and some intelligence dissemination duties. A separate administrative and economic staff, this one entirely composed of civilians, also handled logistics, pay, and medical functions. While this was a leap ahead in organizations as compared to earlier staffs, it was not formalized or institutionalized. Functions and processes were highly dependent on the personalities of the staff officers and clerks, and not the least upon Napoleon himself. It was designed by and for one of the most unrelenting micromanagers in history. He even insisted on analyzing raw intelligence personally, rather than allowing his staff to do so. While Napoleon's system also depended on staffs at lower levels of command, it fell victim to the Achilles heel of all command and control systems, over-centralization. Napoleon tried to do everything himself, running the French Empire and fighting battles simultaneously. He never delegated enough authority and responsibility to make it work. Also important to note is that Napoleon cherry-picked ideas from the Enlightenment and ignored them and others when it suited him. He reinstated vicious, race-based slavery in the French colonies, even though it had been banned, to fuel his imperial ambitions and snuffed out nascent French democracy in his pursuit of personal power. The French army would retain this staff system through the 20th century. The U.S. Army adopted it from the French during World War I. Britain and the Commonwealth countries used a slightly different system, the major difference being that operations and intelligence staffs were combined. German staffs were inspired by Napoleon's example and will be covered extensively in Chapter 3. Conclusion. The intellectual developments of the 18th century, both civil and military, mixed in such a way as to transform warfare. The Enlightenment and the military Enlightenment occurred just before an immense series of changes in warfare driven by technology. Napoleon Bonaparte's career also began just before this inflection point. For centuries, war in Europe was the personal interest of sovereignty.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.